สวัสดีค่ะ See you again on this video. We will learn about the thermodynamics variable called free energy or G. This will be a single variable that used to identify spontaneity of reaction. Now let's revise on the criteria for spontaneity that we learned from the previous video. The entropy of the universe increases in a spontaneous process, which means for one reaction to be spontaneous, the delta S of universe must be more than zero, or it has to be in a positive value. The delta S of system minus delta H of system divided by temperature must be a positive value. It means that we must know both the enthalpy and entropy changes of the system. The question is, can we have just one criterion or one variable to indicate the reaction spontaneity? And good for us that we have. And that variable is called the free energy, or we use the capital letter G. By definition, it is a function that combines the system enthalpy and entropy. It's combined the system enthalpy and entropy. So we can have this relationship. G is equal to H minus TS, and of course T must be in Kelvin unit. Free energy change and spontaneity. The free energy change, or delta G, is a measure of the spontaneity of the process. From this relationship, delta S of universe equal to delta S of system minus delta H of system divided by T. If we multiply throughout the equation with negative T and then rearrange, so we will get a negative T delta S universe with equal to delta H of system minus T delta S of system. From here, we know that this delta H of system minus T delta S of system equal to delta G of system. Therefore, a spontaneous process will have delta G less than zero, because delta G of system is now equal negative T delta S of universe. For a spontaneous process, delta S of universe must be positive. Negative T here would make this whole term become a negative sign for a spontaneous process, which means delta G must be in a negative sign as well for a spontaneous process. Now, how to get or calculate the value of delta G of system or delta G of the reaction of interest? We have seen this relationship already. Delta G of system is calculated from delta H of system minus T delta S of system. And of course, just like delta H and S, we have delta G of formation, which is used to calculate delta G of reaction. Just the same pattern. You have seen this twice for delta H and delta S of reaction already. Delta G of reaction is equal to summation of delta G of formation of product multiplied by its stoichiometry coefficient. If you have a lot of product, add them up together first and then minus the summation of delta G of formation of reactant multiplied by its stoichiometry coefficient. This delta G of formation has the same properties as delta H of formation, so that for the most stable state of the element, you're gonna have delta G of formation equal to zero as well. So let's see some examples. I cut some of the value from the appendix file to show you here. For example, aluminium. The most stable state of aluminium element is aluminium in the solid form. It will have delta HF as zero, and that also delta GF would be zero as well, where entropy or S is not zero. The same occur for barium. Barium in a solid state has delta HF equal to zero, delta GF equal to zero, and this is the most stable state of barium element. For calcium, and that occur for calcium in the solid state. For carbon, it is carbon in the graphite form only that show delta HF and delta GF as zero. And for the diatomic gas like chlorine, nitrogen, and oxygen, the chlorine diatomic gas has delta HF zero, delta GF zero, and this is the most standard state of chlorine element. Same as nitrogen, you see here zero and zero, and oxygen as well, where the S are not zero. So don't misunderstand, don't mix it up, nakha. Only delta HF and delta GF are zero for the most standard state of each element. Let's see some example on the sign of delta G and the spontaneity of the process. And in this example, you are given the value of delta H and delta S of this reaction. Solid water change to liquid water. Use these two values to calculate delta G at minus 10 degrees Celsius and 10 degrees Celsius, and determine whether at each temperature this reaction is spontaneous or not. So now we have delta S and delta H. So we're gonna use the relationship delta G equal to delta H minus T delta S and calculate at each temperature separately. Use this value and this value, nakha. And this is the formula. At minus 10 degrees Celsius, don't forget to change this into Kelvin, and that makes 263 Kelvin. Delta H of system is given as 6.00 times 10 over 3 joule, and minus T 263 Kelvin times 22.1 joule per Kelvin, and you get your answer as 188 joule. This is a positive value. At 10 degrees Celsius, you do the same thing. Change temperature 10 degrees Celsius, make 283 Kelvin, and that you will get the number as negative 254 joules. So you see the criteria for the spontaneous is that A spontaneous process must have delta G of system in a negative value. So at minus 10 degrees Celsius, the process changing solid water to liquid water is not spontaneous or non-spontaneous. That makes sense to you, right? Because at the temperature below the freezing point, the ice will not change into liquid. Where you see at 10 degrees Celsius, the temperature is higher than its freezing point, you get delta G as a negative value. And this reaction, this process will be spontaneous, which means at the temperature higher than the freezing point, ice will change into liquid. Okay, so you see from this example that delta G of one process also depends on the temperature at that point. Let's see some more example. This example, you got the statement, a reaction of calcium oxide with the pollutant sulfur trioxide has been proposed as one way to remove sulfur trioxide from the smoke and that resulting from burning of coal that contains sulfur. So this is one method to help reduce the bad gas or pollution. The question tells you to use the delta G of formation values from the appendix files to calculate delta G of this reaction and also determine if that process is spontaneous under standard state condition. When you see under standard state condition, it's at 1 atmosphere and normally at 25 degrees Celsius or 298 Kelvin. This is how we do it. As you are asked to use delta G of formation, so you're gonna have to think about this formula. Delta G of reaction is the summation of delta G of formation of product minus summation of delta G of formation of reactants. And get all the relative value of each substance from the appendix file, and then it's shown here on this slide the value for calcium oxide, for sulfur trioxide, and for calcium sulfate. Once you got all the number, you will do the calculation. It's pretty easy now. And in this example, number of mole or stoichiometry coefficient is 111, so it's make it even more easy to calculate. And you get the answer as a negative value of delta G. So tell me that is the reaction or this process spontaneous or not? Negative value of G is going to be spontaneous. Move on to the next topic, and this topic is quite important, relationship between the free energy change and chemical equilibrium. Chemical equilibrium, we learned about that in chapter 1. On the general chemistry tool already, K equilibrium constant. We got this relationship between two variables. Delta G is equal to negative RT natural log K. In this particular relationship, we have to use the gas constant equal to 8.314 joule per mole Kelvin. This is very important relationship because it allows us to calculate delta G of the reaction if we know equilibrium constant, or in the opposite way around. If you know equilibrium constant, you can calculate delta G. And these two variables must tell about the reaction in the same pattern. We know that a large value of K, a large value of K means the reaction from left to right or from reactant to product will be preferred. At equilibrium, we get a lot of product compared to reactant. And with this mean, a large value of K from this equation, you would get a very large negative value of delta G as well, which means that the reaction in direction from reactant to product will be very much spontaneous. So it can occur by itself very easily. Let's see the example on how to use the relationship between delta G and K. This example tells you to use the value of delta G of formation again to calculate equilibrium constant K of the following reaction. We don't have specific relationship between delta G of formation of substance with K. We only have relationship of delta G of reaction with K. So in this example, you have to find out what is delta G of reaction first and then get the K value. So here it is, doing calculation for delta G of reaction. And you get this value in a positive number. Positive number means this process is non-spontaneous. So we can have a hypothetic value of K now that the K shouldn't be a large value, right? So this equilibrium should be on the left side. Let's see, do we get the correct hypothesis? So from this reaction, this equation, substitute the delta G value that you got here. Substitute the value of R, 8.314, at this 25 degrees Celsius. Don't forget to change to Kelvin. And you will get the value of K as, you see, K is 6.80 times 10 to minus 84, which means the K is very, very small in relate to this positive delta G. This reaction, the breakdown of water liquid into hydrogen gas and oxygen gas, is unlikely to occur at 25 degrees Celsius. It is a non-spontaneous process and the K value is very low, which means at 25 degrees Celsius, a normal temperature, we don't see the breaking down of water into gases. Otherwise, how can we drink water every day, right? So the value makes sense, So this is one thing that you should be able to judge your answer. Does it make sense to you? I'm not saying that you should be able to do it for every reaction, but something like this, you know water, you know hydrogen gas, you know oxygen gas. Do the numbers make sense to you? Think about it. Now that we've learned about spontaneous process, the meaning of spontaneous process or the criteria to predict whether a reaction of interest is a spontaneous one or not. The criteria to look at the spontaneous is the entropy change of universe or the free energy change of the system. Check the sign carefully. If you look at delta S of universe, the positive sign means spontaneous process. If you look at the free energy change of system, a negative sign means spontaneous process. The next question would be, can we change a non-spontaneous process to be a spontaneous one? In other words, if you have a process that at that condition it is a non-spontaneous, can you do anything to change the condition to make your process become spontaneous one? This would be very important things to consider if you are one of the person who have to make decision on the process control. How would you change the method, or how would you set up a condition to make your process good to go? The answer to this question is yes, we can change a spontaneous process to be a spontaneous one by changing some condition of a process. At least we can do two things. Number one, change temperature of a process. Number two, use couple reaction. Check on the changing of temperature. If you can still recall the example of process of changing solid water to liquid water that we did earlier, the process is non-spontaneous when the temperature is lower than the freezing point, and it is spontaneous when the temperature is above the freezing point. So you can see that changing temperature can change a process to be non-spontaneous or spontaneous. And the second one here, use couple reaction. This is just like you need to find some help. If you have a non-spontaneous process, you need to make it occur together or coupled with a spontaneous process so that the total change of the free energy would give you a negative sign, which make the whole process or the final reaction become a spontaneous one. We're gonna see the example after this slide. So see the change in temperature effect, spontaneity. We know that delta G of system equal to delta H of system minus T delta S of system. Sign of delta G show reaction spontaneity. For a spontaneous process, delta G would be negative. For a non-spontaneous process, delta G would be positive. Delta G will be positive or negative depend on the sign of delta H, the sign of delta S, and also the temperature. And sign of delta H can be positive or negative, as well as the sign of delta S can be positive or negative as well. So combination of negative H, negative S, or positive H, positive S can make a total of four cases as shown on this slide. As see, you see case one, H negative, S positive. Case two, H positive, S negative. Case three, H negative, S negative. Case four, H positive and S positive. Okay. And the result, delta G, will be positive or negative. We will see what can be possible. However, let me change this equation slightly so we can see the combination of sign easier, hopefully. I change this,
the equation into this form, where you have delta G, which now depends on temperature, will be equal to delta H of the system plus this term, negative T delta S. T is the absolute temperature in Kelvin unit. So the value of T is always a positive value, okay? So when you have the combination of delta H of system and negative T delta S, we look at the sign of these two columns, okay? We look at the sign of these two columns. Simple mathematics. When you add
positive and positive, the result would be positive, right? When you add negative and negative, the result would be negative, okay? As you see here, negative delta H plus negative minus T delta S, the delta G would always be negative value. When delta G is negative value, it means that your process or your reaction would be spontaneous. So negative value G here doesn't depend on temperature, because this term is always a negative plus negative, you will always get negative G. Your process or your reaction will always be spontaneous. So you can't change temperature to make it non-spontaneous. Same for case number two. When you have positive delta H and positive negative T delta S, positive plus positive will always give you a positive delta G. When you have positive delta G, it means that your process or your reaction is non-spontaneous at every temperature. So you cannot do anything to change temperature and make it into a spontaneous process. Okay? Unlike case 3 and case 4. Case 3 and case 4, you have same sign of delta H and delta S, which make this second term minus T delta S has different sign to the delta H. This time, the combination will depend on how much positive the second term is, how much positive the second term is, which means if you have high temp, this term will be much more positive. And that will result as a much more positive delta G. Hear me again. This term is positive, and it will be more positive when temperature is high. When temperature is high, this term is more positive. Combined with a fixed delta H, at high temperature, your delta G would be more positive. And it shows here, your process or your reaction would be non-spontaneous at higher temperature. Okay? Which make it obvious for the opposite direction. When your process is non-spontaneous at higher temperature, it will be more spontaneous at lower temperature. Let's hear it again in case number four.
Case number 4, you have same sign of delta H and delta S, which make negative T delta S in a negative value. So depends on temperature again. How much is the negative value of this term? At higher temperature, this term will be more negative, which is then combined with a fixed delta H. Your result, delta G, would be more negative. So that your process is going to be more spontaneous at higher temperature. Okay. Well, put it in a different picture. Same thing, just different picture. Okay. So you have two choices of delta H of system. It's either negative or positive. You also have two choices for delta S of system, either positive or negative. Okay. So the combination of delta H and delta S here make delta G of system. Alright. This equation, same equation as previous one. If you have this combination, negative delta H, positive delta S, delta G would always be a negative value. And that means it's always spontaneous. Doesn't depend on temperature. Look at this also. When you have positive delta H, negative delta S, your delta G results will always be positive. And that means the process is non-spontaneous at all temperature. When you have same sign of delta H and delta S, like positive delta H, positive delta S. Delta S is in your second term. You want delta G to be more negative for it to be spontaneous. Okay. So you need high temp. So that this second term will be increased and your delta G would be more negative. So it shows here this combination gives you spontaneous process at high temperature. The last one, you have negative delta H, negative delta S. Negative delta S will make this negative and negative. Your second term would be positive. Okay, positive. You want delta G to be negative. It's gonna be negative when temperature is low. Okay, so your second term is smaller than delta H, and that's gonna be result of negative delta G. Now let's see if you can use the information about the sign of delta H and sign of delta S and then predict the change of the spontaneity of your process depending on temperature. On this example, you have this reaction. Sulfur dioxide react with oxygen and give you sulfur trioxide. At 25 degrees Celsius or 298 Kelvin, the results show that your delta G is negative 141.6 kilojoule, delta H negative 198.4 kilojoules, and delta S negative 187.9 joule per Kelvin. A. Use data to decide if the change is spontaneous at 298 Kelvin. This is a straightforward question. Is the reaction spontaneous at specific temperature? You look at the sign of delta G, right? Without doing any calculation, the given information show that at this temperature, delta G is negative. Therefore, you can answer this already. Yes? Yes. Your process is spontaneous. Okay. The next question is how delta G will change with increasing temperature. So it is asking you how delta G would change if the temperature is increased. Okay. How delta G will change if the temperature is increased. Without doing calculation, we look at delta H and delta S signed here. We have same sign of delta H and delta S. Okay. Negative and negative. So this fit case number 3. This fit case number 3. Delta H is negative. Delta S is also negative. And that gives you a result of delta G either positive or negative depends on the value of temperature. And this case, if you increase temperature or at higher temp, your process will be more non-spontaneous, which means your delta G would be more positive. Okay, it would be more positive. And you check it with the question. Assume that delta H and delta S are constant with temperature. So you use the given value here. Is the reaction spontaneous at 900 degrees Celsius? You see, increased temperature. Is the reaction spontaneous? From this chart or this result of case number 3, your answer would be at this high temp, the reaction should be non-spontaneous. All right, let's find out. From the relationship or from equation delta G equal to delta H minus T delta S, substitute the values in. Remember to use the same unit, otherwise you can't add it up. Kilojoule change into joule times 10 over 3 minus temperature change into Kelvin. 900 degrees Celsius become 1173 Kelvin, and this is your delta S, and you will get the result delta G at 900 degrees Celsius or 1173 Kelvin is 22 kilojoules positive. You see, delta G would be more positive at high temp. All right.
Now that we know we can change temperature, increase it or decrease it to make it spontaneous, the next question is how much do we have to increase temperature or increase it until when so that it can be spontaneous, or if we need to decrease it, we would decrease it until when, until what temperature to make it spontaneous. The condition where we can change temperature to make the spontaneous become non-spontaneous or vice versa is when we have the same sign of delta H and delta S. Okay, it would certainly be useful to know the temperature at which a reaction will become spontaneous, and this is the crossover temperature. You have to cross this temperature so that the spontaneity of the process will change. So we're gonna set the delta G to be zero. Delta G to be zero. This is something like an equilibrium point. And then rearrange it. We're gonna get temperature would be equal to delta H divided by delta S. Okay, delta G is zero. And then move this to this side. Okay, T would be this condition. This temperature is the crossover temperature. Example. See, as I said, it would be very useful to know the temperature at which the reaction will be spontaneous in order to control the direction of reversible reaction. This decomposition of calcium carbonate to be calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. At 25 degrees Celsius, we have delta H, a positive value, endothermic process. We have delta S in a positive value. The decomposition will increase entropy. As you see, the product has gas where reactant doesn't have gas, only have solid. Entropy of product is higher than entropy of reactant. Therefore, delta S is a positive sign. This is case number 4, where we have positive delta H, positive delta S. This case number 4, it will be spontaneous at higher temp. It will be spontaneous at higher temp. So we need to increase temperature. We need to increase temperature. But can we increase to just 30 degrees Celsius? Or how much do we have to increase the temperature? To set the crossover temperature, we can calculate by the previous slide like this. Find out the crossover temperature. Put delta H and delta S. Okay. Remember, you need to make the same unit of energy. Okay. You can either make both into kilojoule, which means you have to divide delta S by 1000. So that you get the temperature, crossover temperature is 1083 Kelvin or 810 degrees Celsius. Let's check it out. So you can check it out yourself by try to calculate delta G of this reaction at 500 degrees Celsius and 900 degrees Celsius. You're gonna find that the temperature must be over 810 degrees Celsius for delta G to become a negative value. Try it yourself, nakha. So we come to the second thing that we can do to change the non-spontaneous to be spontaneous by one using couple reaction. You need some help. So couple reaction means you make a new overall reaction that have a negative value of delta G. Say you have one reaction with positive delta G, this is your non-spontaneous process. You need to find another reaction with a negative delta G to couple with your first one. And this negative delta G reaction has to be spontaneous enough or have a large negative value of delta G to win over and get the overall spontaneous process. This is the So see, you have non-spontaneous process, copper oxide decomposed to copper and some oxygen. This is a non-spontaneous process as shown by positive value of delta G. Even at high temperature already, it is still non-spontaneous. So you can make this process more spontaneous by couple it with a spontaneous process like this one, graphite in oxygen and give you carbon monoxide. This is a spontaneous process with negative value of delta G, and it is negative enough to add together, you get overall reaction that has delta G in a negative value. So this overall reaction is a spontaneous process. This couple reaction is very much similar to the concept of Hess's law, where you add delta H together for the overall process. You can also add delta G together to see if your overall reaction will become spontaneous or not. Naka. So here we are come to the end of this video. Let's make the summary of what you've learned in this video. We learned about free energy change because from previous video, in order to predict spontaneity of a process, we need to know both the enthalpy change and entropy change of the system. It would be better if we can make just one variable for this kind of prediction. And yes, we can combine both enthalpy change and entropy change into what we call a free energy change or delta G to predict the system spontaneity. And for a system or a reaction to be a spontaneous process, the delta G of reaction must be in a negative value. And if we have delta H and delta S in the same sign, positive and positive or negative and negative, the delta G will depend on the temperature, which means you have the crossover temperature to change from non-spontaneous process into a spontaneous one. We can also make a couple reaction to get the overall spontaneous reaction. And then this is the end of the chapter 5 on chemical thermodynamics. Naka. Go back to the previous video if you still not quite sure about the concept. Naka. And please find some exercise to practice on the calculation. Remember, sign, positive, negative, and also unit are very important in calculation นะคะด้วยความห่วงใยนะคะตั้งใจเรียนหนังสือนะคะสวัสดีค่ะ See you on the next chapter. Bye bye ค่ะ